Oxico Resources Canada Inc. is a Montreal-based mining exploration company founded in 2014. Oxico is engaged in the acquisition, exploration, and development of mineral properties in Mexico and Colombia. Oxico Resources Canada Inc. is listed on the Canadian Securities Exchange under the symbol AUAG.
Joining me today, we have Pierre Gauthier, CEO of Oxico Resources. Now, you're based in Montreal, correct?
Correct.
And you've been on Bay Street for a long time.
Absolutely.
Like we're a couple of warriors.
Absolutely.
Correct?
Yes.
And as your ticker would say, AUAG, yeah. Now it's got to have something to do with gold and silver.
Absolutely.
Periodic symbols for gold and silver.
Absolutely.
And you're, now you started off in Mexico.
Yep.
But I understand there's been some developments.
Yeah.
And you've been sort of focusing on Colombia.
Absolutely.
Let's talk about Colombia.
All right.
Okay.
So when you go to a new country like that, you have to go there with a competitive edge or else you shouldn't be there. And it happens that...
Did somebody say...
No, my legal assistant in my office is Colombian. Her name is Pilar Acosta, and her husband is Colombian. And as I got to know him, he was the assistant of two past presidents of
this
the country.
This is totally random.
Yeah, it's random. They're in my office. I meet the husband, and he's been the assistant of the past two presidents. He worked for Pricewaterhouse for 10 years in Colombia, and he knows everybody.
Is he a financial guy?
He's a financial guy, absolutely.
Okay. So he knows top
yeah,
government.
Everybody. So he invited me to go to Colombia for a week. I sat in a hotel room, had 8 meetings a day, and realized he knew everybody.
Come on.
Absolutely. So then
right under your nose.
Yeah, right there. So all of a sudden, with that 1 week, we decided to go there because of the access to properties, people, governments, legislation,
and
everything.
And the mood's changed in Colombia from say, 10 years ago.
Very good point, Ed, absolutely.
Because the political situation's a lot...
Well, yeah, here's what's changed, is that there was a war there for 42 years with the FARC.
Yes.
And that war ended about a year and a half ago. And with that settlement, you had about a third of the country that was off limits in terms of natural resources. So here you have this treasure chest of minerals that's had no activity for 42 years because of this war. That's true.
Yeah.
So in my lifetime in mining, when you can catch an event like that, either a political change where the laws get revamped to encourage investment,
yes,
or access to mineral resources that have been off limits for 42 years, that's a one in a lifetime opportunity. And when you can do that with with a partner that has access to all the right people, you know, the odds are stacked in your favor.
So you had to give your assistant some stock options.
I did. And his wife.
Yeah. So I know. And everybody that goes to Colombia loves Colombia now.
Yeah.
It's gone from a hated place to a revered place.
Yeah. And there was another consideration is that you've got
some technology.
That's it. That's what I want to talk about. Absolutely. So there's something called the Minamata Convention in the world. It's a UN convention signed by 144 countries.
Right.
That eliminates the use of mercury in artisanal mining. And Colombia is one of those countries that signed that convention. So they have a problem is that there's all kinds of people, artisans, that make a living mining gold and extracting it with mercury. They can't put them out of a business. You know, you'd have a revolution on your hands if you stopped
that. These are artisanal miners.
Artisanal miners.
So they're out there chipping away, trying to make a living, right?
But they use mercury to extract the gold. So you have
and mercury is considered a very poisonous
for the human being and for the environment.
Yeah, I remember in chemistry class we used to play with mercury. And
absolutely,
don't play with it anymore.
So Oxico has this technology to extract gold and silver without the use of mercury or cyanide.
Now, how did you get that technology?
Well, that was developed in Canada. I've been financing innovation in mining and metallurgy for a number of years.
Yes,
and through an associate company, we licensed Oxico with the rights to this technology. And when the governor of the state of Bolivar found this out, then that would solve his legal problem in terms of creating a new way to extract gold and silver without the use of mercury and allowing the indigenous people to continue to work under legal terms, the right legal terms, okay?
Right.
So we signed an agreement with...
I bet you there's a lot of these indigenous miners that are trying to make a... Right?
What it is here, there's 100 million ounces of gold produced worldwide. 20 million of those ounces are produced by artisanal miners, Africa, Central America, Latin America.
Wow.
It's huge.
Wow.
So this is a big problem.
Ma and pop operations.
Yeah, yeah. But all the governments now need to solve this. And we happen to have a technology that does not use mercury or cyanide that can do this in one.
But is this technology, like how proven is this technology?
Well,
I mean, it's early days, right?
It's early days, but you know what? What's the alternative? There's nothing else.
Right.
Okay, so I'll answer it that way. And it's very simple technology.
Okay.
It uses ultrasound extraction to break up particles so that you can get them out faster. It's that simple. You know, if you went to a hospital and you had a kidney stone problem,
I know.
They use ultrasound to break it up.
Well, they clean your teeth using ultrasound, right?
So it's the same thing. If you put ultrasound in
when you get old like me, you got a lot of problems with your teeth. They need a special.
So that's right. So it's inoffensive, but it breaks down particles into nanoparticles.
Yes.
And allows you to get them out a lot faster. So we signed with the governor to do this in the state of Bolivar. When that happened, we had about 20 companies call us that wanted the technology. And how we did the business in Colombia.
So what do? They send you samples and stuff?
Well, we sign option agreements on those properties first, because I didn't want to start spending a bunch of money and then have to negotiate terms. So all of a sudden, we're getting all these samples in Canada.
And this is all because of your relationship with your assistant?
Well, and the deal with the governor.
The governor announced this. He introduced you.
So that got a lot of press in Colombia. Samples started coming in, and then we started getting these samples that had nothing to do with gold. They were like gravels.
And you're looking at them thinking, what is this?
Absolutely.
But did you test them?
Yeah, of course we did. So on analysis, this is coltan material, tantalum and niobium.
Which are expensive minerals.
Very expensive and very rare.
Are they elements? They're in the periodic table.
And so just to talk about that.
But they're rare.
Yeah, they're
rare. And expensive.
And very expensive. But now they're being mined in the Congo. Okay, and tantalum goes in. How many cell phones are there in the world today? Maybe 6 billion, as many humans. Well, tantalum is in every cell phone and every computer. So the large companies, Samsung, Apple, they have to buy this stuff. It's being produced out of the Congo, and as you know, in the Congo, there's
The Congo is not exactly a picnic place.
No, it
right?
isn't. But you know, there's issues with child labor, human rights abuses, etc. So if you're some of those large companies, you'd rather not buy from there if possible. But if that's the only place it comes from, you're sort of stuck. So all of a sudden, the opportunity for us as a company that Colombia, the war is over, it opens up, and they have very important reserves with this coltan, and we're right in the heart of this right now.
Did you get some grades that you thought were a bit amazing?
Yeah, we did. You know, these are gravels, and you know, some of our press releases indicate what those grades are, but it's running as high as 35% tantalum. So if you did some math on that a little bit, tantalum sells for $90 a pound. So if you got 35% of your rock that's tantalum, that's about 600 pounds out of a ton. At $30 a ton, do the math on that, it's $50,000 a ton of tantalum value.
$50,000 a ton? I mean, the only thing I know of that's $50,000 a ton is uranium. I'm sure there's some gold deposit, but it's rare.
Yeah,
like you get $1,000 rock, people are excited.
That's absolutely.
So $50,000, not $5,000.
No, $50,000. But, you know, so what's happened here?
But you don't know how much of this stuff is over there.
Not yet.
Have you gone and taken a...
Absolutely.
Are you going to bring me with you?
Yeah, if you want. No, I don't think you want to go. I don't think you want to, but if you want to come, you're most welcome, but it's difficult. You know, but these are gravel deposits.
This is at surface.
At surface, in the riverbeds, and they've been concentrated by nature over the years. So think of a river coming down, and in the bend...
Over millions of years.
Over millions of years. And this tantalum is very heavy. It has it's almost as heavy as gold. It has a specific gravity of 16, gold is 18. So something really heavy that's being washed all the time stays behind and the light stuff goes on.
Yes.
So it's this natural phenomena of being washed by nature that creates a concentration with these kind of numbers.
You've taken some photos, and we've got some of those photos now of what these gravels look like, and we can see this on the screen, and that's what you tested.
Yeah, so when we receive samples, in order to have an idea of what they are they hard rock, are they anything else, the lab takes a picture like this before we analyze it, just so we can have a sense of what the material looks
like. Right.
So in this case, you know, you can see these are gravels, they haven't been grounded, they've perhaps been concentrated in riverbeds like I was talking about. So that's what was analyzed in our lab.
So is that niobium and tantalum?
Absolutely. That would be, that sample could be 30% tantalum, perhaps 20% niobium. And there are other elements in there that are quite fascinating, like scandium, for instance.
Is that right?
Yeah.
And so this stuff is just sitting there.
Yep.
Is that right? Am I making it sound a little too easy?
No. Well,
so I should take a trip down there with a bag and start shoveling this stuff in there.
Well, if you knew where it was, you could. But you know,
and you're not going to tell me.
No, but this is in the Amazon. Access is very difficult. You know,
but it sounds like, I mean, if it's just sitting there, it's surface. You know, most of the time you hit something high grade, it's you know, 500 meters down.
Yeah.
And where do you start, right?
I know. Well, like I said, this is not hard rock. It's gravels that have been concentrated
by
alluvial deposits
concentrated by nature. Sure.
You know, and the indigenous people, when you go in there, you have to work with them, collaborate with them. And we've signed an agreement with the governor of the state of Bolivar now to organize commercial exploitation of this coltan, all right? And then, you know, so there are other elements in here. When you sell it, it can't be radioactive. There tends to be a bit of uranium and thorium in there. So yeah, those levels have to be below a certain amount in order to be able to sell it commercially worldwide, you know? So,
right.
We've been doing a lot of lab testing on this, Ed, in terms of how do you increase the values through gravity and magnetic separation? How do you reduce the value of radioactivity? So these are some of the things we can do for the indigenous people as they could supply us their ore, and we have a profit split with them, 70% to us and 30% to them. So we want to bring technology to the table to upgrade the value of the ore, make it more commercial, and allow local people to earn a living with us.
Wow. Fascinating. So you've also shown us a chart. The lower the value of the rock, the much more capital expenditure you need. And therefore, it gets a little boring if you're talking $300-$400 a ton. And that's a lot of and that's what people want in a lot of cases, right?
Yeah, I'll put it this way. I've been in the mining business for 30 years. I've had projects pretty well on every continent all over the world, you know? And, you know, at the end of the day, you know, as you know, high grade rules the game, you know, because that can offset a lot of mistakes you're going to make.
And by the way, before I forget, that chart only went up to 10,000, and you're talking multiples of that.
Yeah. So what I want to explain to you is that 90% of the business lives right down in that corner at the bottom, where your rock value is never more than $500 a ton. And to make a project happen, you probably need $100 million to do it. So that $100 million creates tremendous dilution for your shareholders.
Right.
Okay, so what kind of project are you looking for? So I have sort of an inverse relationship where you're looking for that project way at the other end that's only $5 million and you're trying to go to a ton that has the highest value possible. So when you do that, you end up you know, with less capital needs, and that's what this ultrasound technology can do also. It can extract minerals in 1 hour as opposed to 20 hours. So it reduces your CapEx.
Was the ultrasound technology, was that created here in Canada?
Yes, it was. Yeah, absolutely.
Interesting.
Yeah.
So Oxico, how many shares outstanding?
44 million shares.
44 million shares. And now you, because I know, even though we haven't met until recently, you know a lot of the people that I know. And like, for instance, Jeff Green is a good friend of mine. And
large shareholder,
and he kept telling me, you got to talk to Pierre, talk to Pierre. He's a big shareholder. You must have a pretty good Rolodex.
I've raised a lot of money in the mining business for over 30 years on a lot of projects everywhere.
Yes.
But I've never come across a project where the value per ton is even close to this.
It's almost
it's singular to the limited amount of this material being produced in the Congo and the demand for it outside the Congo. You know, so the buyers now are asking us for a certificate of origin. Okay? We have to say it comes from Colombia.
Does most of it now come from the Congo? Is it all come from the Congo?
60% comes from the Congo. But this could be a big replacement source, okay? Because it's a large area.
Right.
There's a lot of it. And like I said, it's just not the tantalum, but the niobium that's in there and other rare earths as scandium. Okay? Scandium sells for $4,000 a kilo, as is in nature. And if you refine it, it's $15,000 a kilo.
So would you have like a couple ounces of scandium? Is it scandium?
Yeah, 4 kilos. We have up to 4 kilos of scandium per ton.
What?
4 kilos per ton. And if you can put that, and if you can refine that, it's worth $15,000 a kilo times 4 kilos. That's $60,000 worth of scandium.
And that's just the scandium?
It's in there. But now we wouldn't be paid for that, because now if you sell this coltan, they'll pay you for the tantalum and nothing else. So the challenge is, let's start selling these tons as soon as possible so we can create some cash flow.
Right.
And then let's see what we can do about taking out the niobium and the scandium and create more value added per ton. Okay, so that's our game plan really right now.
Yeah, so got to be exciting. It just sounds like you just fell into this kind of.
Yeah, we did because of the geopolitics, the area becoming open, having access to the right people.
Right.
And having a technology that can contribute to optimizing the value of these, okay? And it's not only Colombia, it's Colombia and the border of Venezuela and the border of Brazil. There's a whole geologic area that covers these three countries, and the geology doesn't know there's a frontier. It's all the same geology.
Of course, the assets don't know.
So we've tested the stuff in Venezuela, in Brazil, and Colombia. So it's not unique to Colombia. It's really in these three countries.
So this is a pretty big deposit.
Well, you know, we can't.
We can't talk about it, but it looks like it could be.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, but you know,
at surface.
So back to the chart. You know, you're not going to have excavators in there breaking the rock to try and mine it. You're not going to have to crush it. You can sell it as is in the picture that's there. All right. So hopefully we'll be concluding some sales here in the near future, and then that'll indicate to the marketplace what
this is
really worth.
So is your plan to generate some cash flow off of this?
Absolutely.
Even if, you know, even a few hundred thousand dollars a month to a small mining company is a lot of money.
Absolutely.
As you know.
Yeah. So I can tell you that we're in touch with five different trading outfits. Japan, Canada, China, etc. They all want this material, and there's specific rules you have to follow for sales. You have to have it in a Brinks warehouse. You have to have independent analysis.
Yes.
It has to be
a protocol.
All of these things, yeah.
Yeah.
So we're into those protocols right now, and I think we'll announce our first sales for the next 30 days.
Pierre, thanks for coming in. We're going to leave it there. We're going to have you back real soon to find out what's going on, because this sounds like something that could be really big.